Hello and welcome to our Learning Draft series with number 6 this time, where we will finish talking about the archetypes by showcasing how the archetypes affect the game. And I want to start this discussion by saying that Legends of Runeterra is designed with these different archetypes in mind. It is a newer card game, and the devs actually knew about these archetypes when they put out the cards and then designed the cards for specific reasons. Another core design philosophy, so knowledge of an archetype helps you with deck building and gameplay. And each region is actually designed for certain archetypes. And another design philosophy is that mono-region decks shouldn't be viable. This was recently mentioned by Ruben Lee regarding the Sun Disk. Sun Disk should always stay a meme card, because mono-region decks should have inherent weaknesses that they aren't able to overcome without going into dual regions. So the core design revolves around dual regions forming strong archetypes. If you just look at the six original archetypes, or the six original regions that are in the game, we can clearly separate them into good stats and bad stats. For example, good stats would be Noxus, Demacia, and Freljord, whereas units with bad stats would be Ionia, Piltover and Zaun, and Shadow Isles. These are the six fundamental regions that came into the game, and the regions I want to focus on the most, because those still show the original design philosophy this game had. If you look at the traditional 1-drop units, we have the Noxus Legion Rearguard, which is a lot of stats but can't block, so it's fully aggressive. We have Cythria with balanced deadline of a 2-2, and we have the Omen Hawk, which actually gives the most stats in a 3-3, but it's very delayed. You grant 2-2 of the stats to 2 of your allies, so you only get those stats later on. And this showcases very well the different stat-based approach. Loxus is aggressive, Demacia is mid-range-ish, and Freljord is slower and even more defensive, but oftentimes more stats overall. If you look at these bad stats classes, we have Ionia, who still can get a lot of stats, but it's more combo-focused, so it offers less stats up front for more of a trickery approach, or gaining more stats later on. Whereas Piltover and Zaun generally has bad stats, but gets a different effect, oftentimes card draw or card cycling, card generation, that's not focused on board advantage and gaining tempo. Next example would be Shadow Isles, which technically has a 2-2, but split up and is also more of a combo region. Hapless Aristocrat is not known for his great stats, but for enabling all these sacrifice combos that Shadow Isles has. It becomes even more clear if you look at the combat tricks. You have Elixir of Wrath granting +3/+0, so only aggressive stats in Noxus. We have Elixir of Iron granting +0/+2, so only defensive stats in Demacia, and Radiant Strike granting the medium +1/+1 in Demacia. Ionia still has a combat trick naming Rush, but this one only gives one stat boost plus the trickery of Quick Attack, showing again that Ionia is the trickery, the combo region. You have to outplay your opponent to get the most value out of your cards. Piltover and Zaun and Shadow Isles don't really have combat tricks. I will just showcase the one cost burst spell, which just summons a Scrap Scuttler, but is more of a combo card in PNC. And Shadow Isles doesn't really have combat tricks as well. The one exception would be Mark of the Isles, which has been mentioned to be an exception by the devs and not really belong in Shadow Isles. That's why it wasn't really shown in wasn't really present in expeditions for a long time. It now is again, but only in the ephemeral archetype, and I wouldn't really consider it a combat trick per se, because it doesn't really help you win a combat. It's just basically deal 2 damage on the ephemeral ally. These 2 health doesn't really matter, because it just dies when it strikes anyways. So more of a combo card as well. And this shows very well the split that was happening between these regions. We have the stat regions that offer a lot of stats, aggressive, defensive or mid-range. So, and we have the combo regions. We can separate those into the faster decks, and the master would be mid-range, and I will call Piltover and Zaun flexible. It can go into both fast strategies and slow strategies, but I'm very hesitant to call PNC mid-range because it's just not really what PNC does. It's just flexible, it can be both fast and slow. And then we have the more slow archetypes in Freljord and Shadow Isles. It becomes even more clear if you look at the interaction, both these strong stats regions have bad interaction, as well as Ionia, since it's more of a combo region, and PNC and Shadow Isles have good interaction, as well as Freljord, since they need this good interaction to get to the later game to use their stats more effectively. Noxus basically only has small removal, situational removal, and damaged unit kills, so not the strongest interaction, removal spells I should say. And Demacia used to have only challengers, so only combat, or single combat, which is basically a fast speed challenge, if you think about it. And Ionia basically only had recoils, so bounce spells, which fits its identity of being a very fast region, a very tempo-focused combo region that tries to win the game very quickly. On the good interaction side, we have PNC, which has all the small removal spells like Mystic Shot and Get Excited, etc., but having trouble dealing with spread out boards or with big units. We have Freljord, which has all of the AoE spells, the board wipes, Avalanche, Blighted, Ice Quake, etc. There are actually no board wipes present in any of these other regions. And then we have Shadow Isles, which offers the hard removal spells, but doesn't really have small removal on cards like Wild Feast. Does one damage pings, but it doesn't really have any way to deal 2 or 3 damage. Doesn't have any AoE spells. It mostly focuses on hard removal. And this was a very interesting split, and one that got me hooked into Runeterra in the first place. This clear distinction between these regions. And it was clearly shown that by design you need to combine two regions for a successful deck. We all played the spider deck in the beginning, and these spiders are split between two regions, Noxus and Shadow Isle, so you have to combine these two to get the full packets. Another example would be Karma, which is a spell-based champion, but there are only bad spells like Ritual of Renewal in Ionia. So if you want to get full value out of Karma, you have to venture into another region like PNC or Shadow Isles to get enough value from Karma. I only talked about these first six regions because I plan to make a separate video on each region and their identity, their strengths and weaknesses, and also going over the combinations and the card pools, starting with Noxus in the next week. So if you want to hear more about these different regions and their identities, just stay tuned. In the newer days, these newer cards sometimes break these rules. We have, for example, Concerted Strike, which is just a unconditional removal for the mid-range region. Concerted Strike is way different than single combat, since it doesn't actively force your unit into the combat, but it's just like a one-sided strike, which Demacia didn't really have before, and I don't really think fits Demacia's identity of fighting, challenging, dueling, and I really don't like this card from a design perspective. Similarly, newer PNC units often have these insane stat lines of like 3-4s, which just doesn't fit this design philosophy of PNC having bad stats as well. But of course, as the game goes longer, you have to include new cards and you have to break some of your own old design philosophies. Newer regions like Bandle City are harder to describe in form of to talk about their inherent weaknesses as well. If you just look at Bandle, they have good stats units, they have swarm units, they have value units, they have swarm win cons, they have combo win cons, they have damage spells, strike spells, combat tricks, hard removal. So basically everything, and that's why many people complain about Battle City not having a clear weakness anymore and not following these traditional design philosophies. Because if you, for example, want to build a swarm deck, you don't need any other region. You have the swarm wincon and the swarm units in the same region, which is just bad design in my opinion. You should have just made your Yordles in Arms, I don't know, a Noxus card or a... not really any other swarm regions, like Ionia card maybe, I don't know. Freljord card, but just having these two, and this is why this whole Battle City Mayor archetype feels so oppressive and constructed, because it on its own is a good archetype in a single region. You can just build a combo deck only in Bandle, you can build a swarm deck only in Bandle. You don't really need any other regions, that's why it's Bandle feels so quote unquote overpowered or without a clear weakness in constructed. But just keep in mind, if you look back at this overview, in the beginning we had these different regions mapped out for different archetypes. Noxus and Ionia for more aggressive, BNC and Demacia for more mid-range strategies, and Freljord and Shadow Isles for these slower strategies. Next up, also the expedition buckets are designed for certain archetypes. You don't have to memorize these buckets in detail if you're just starting out. These are definitely not necessary to memorize. I just want to show you that, for example, the scrap heap bucket, if you just look at all the cards represented, that's what I did. I just took all the cards and put them into a deck in Terra and just looked at the curve. You can see that scrap heap has a lot of 1 drops, 2 drops, 3 drops, and 4 drops. So basically, very aggressive curve, and this leads to more of a swarm archetype. If you try to build a control deck or a mid-range deck with the scrap heap, you will find to have many, many 1 drops, 2 drops, 3 drops, but not any 5 drops, 6 drops, 7 drops, because those are mostly epics. Example of a mid-range curve would be this Challenger card pool, which just focuses on the 4 drops and 5 drops. We see 9, and we also see a decent curve overall. And the Enlightenment bucket, for example, is more of a control bucket. We see here that a big focus on these 7 plus cards, this late game, and overall a mediocre curve leading up to that. So just keep that in mind. You will have more success drafting. Even these expedition buckets are built around certain archetypes and supporting one archetype more than the others. So what does it mean for your gameplay? You should draft for a specific archetype. And you should pick two champs who synergize and want to go in the same archetype and focus on the same thing. Like say you pick Lucian in the first pick. Lucian is a 2-drop and is very aggressive, as you can see in this keyword, quick attack. And he gets double attack when he levels up. So he wants to attack, he wants to flip soon to make value out of his stats. If you get these three options, then it should be obvious to you which option you want to go for. Lucian is an early game champion, so you don't want a Nivea, which wants to go to turn 10. That's just two different archetypes. Lucian wants to be aggressive, tempo-based, whereas Nivea wants to be slow and controlish. Similarly, you don't want Kindred, because Kindred is like a trick champion. She has quick attack, but doesn't really want to attack. You see that in her bad stat line, just a 4-4-4-5 mana. She wants to be more of a backline champion and generate value over time by these slay mechanics. So the natural fit for Lucian would be Kalista, another low-cost champion with the Fearsome keyword, also wanting to attack, her level up also benefits from attacking, and this would be the natural pairing. And this is how you should decide which two champions you pick up, because as we see later, these card pools also synergize more together. And you should try to get cards that fit your archetype in synergy picks while picking good cards in wild picks. You get 8 synergy picks and 8 wild picks, and you can actively influence your draft by going for these archetypes in your synergy picks. And you can't really influence your wild picks, but you can still pick up good cards there. And you often see me just going for different buckets, even if they have weaker cards, to try and force a certain archetype, to try and show the draft system I want to have cards from a certain archetype. Next, let's talk about deck building and why certain archetypes are more prevalent in expeditions than others. Let's look at what each archetype needs. Swarm, which I said like 10% of decks are, needs multiple cheap units and group buffs. As you see with spiders, those are a little bit split in two different regions as well. We have like swarm units in Noxus and swarm units in Freljord. We have payoff in Noxus and payoff in Shadow Isles, I should say, not Freljord, excuse me. So you need both halves, both regions to make a good swarm spire deck in expeditions. On the other hand, fast combo decks obviously need their combo pieces, which ideally are split in two regions as well, as seen with the infamous Azir Aurelia combination needing two different regions. Tempo decks need those strong standalone units that you often find in Ionia, and protection spells. Now, Ionia doesn't really have protection spells, and I should talk about this design philosophy of adding exceptions to the rule to each archetype, because when questioned about these the hard removal in Bandle City, they said they like to include one or two cards that break these archetype rules. Similarly, the only card that gives you health in Ionia is the Twin Disciplines, Discipline of Fortitude, and this is not really something that Ionia does on its own. It's more of an aggressive region. It's just that Twin Disciplines breaks this rule. So you see Twin Disciplines in basically every Ionia deck, since it does something which Ionia isn't really supposed to do. If you want to be consistent, you have to go into other archetypes to find, or other regions to find protection spells. For example, Demacia or Freljord have a lot of health buffs. And this is why you see combinations of Ionia and Freljord, Ionia, Demacia, if you want to have a tempo deck oftentimes. Mid-range decks just need good units on curve, and that's really it. That's the most important thing you need for mid-range decks. And you also need like removal and early or late game. Luckily, in Demacia, we find both a early game and late game with the dragon package that just included this Akkad Research, which is great as early game and also provides you late game by drawing you random dragon followers. If you have 4 or 5 in this in your hand, you're fine early and late. And with the introduction of Concerted Strike, they also have an unconditional removal spell. And this is why Demacia is, in my opinion, the strongest region, because it has all the tools in its own region right now to be a mid-range deck. Combo control needs control tools, which are rare, and furthermore a strong combo. And having these slow, always game-winning combos is even harder in expeditions. And the only one that's really one card combo is Feel the Rush, but others are really hard to obtain and get the control tools as well. Vision control needs these control tools as well, plus a value engine. Again, if you have these good control tools like Freljord and PNC, you won't really have these value engines. Freljord is not noticed for value, it's noticed for big stats, which sometimes gives you value, but the most notable value engines are like Karma, Targon, and both Ionia and Targon don't have these control tools at all. They don't have any removal, they only have the value basically, so you have to combine two regions here as well. The only archetype that is really self-sufficient right now is mid-range in Demacia, basically has everything it needs on its own. So combos are hard to reliably get in expeditions, you shouldn't focus on them. And tempo, swarm and control both need specific cards to be viable. You need to have these high power units and protection spells, you need to have the swarm units and payoff, and you need to have these control tools to make these decks viable, whereas mid-range is the most reliable archetype and can be self-sufficient in Demacia. And you should just focus on these regions, Demacia, Noxus, Freljord, and also Shurima, which is more of a stat-based region as well, and just focus on your curve, having 2 drops, 3 drops, 4 drops, 5 drops. I've talked about this in the second video, so you can go and rewatch this if you don't remember it anymore. And this is my basic approach to expeditions for newer players and intermediate players as well. Just to show you how this works, I will show you 2 decks that just went straight up 7 wins. This one is just a Pop Vishivana deck, which basically only has Demacia. If you look at this, we have both the early game in Demacia, like a little bit of Bandle City sprinkled in. We have strong mid game units in the Mars here, and we have insane late game with Cythria, Genevieve, Cythria the Bold. We also have Interaction in the Mars here, and just one random minimorph sprinkled in for the hard removal of Bandle City. Another example would be this one. Unfortunately, these Screeching Dragons are not really shown yet, because this Aloha Guardian doesn't show more if you have more than three of the same card in it. And again, these Freljord cards are just filler. We have just three random units or four with Kalista. You have one card draw spell and the Withering Mist, but the rest of this 7-0 deck are just the Master units. And you have these Challengers, you have this Interaction spell, you have Protection spells, you have Combat Tricks, so the Master is just able to build a deck, and a really strong deck, by itself now. That's the main weakness of not having Interaction, or strong Interaction, has been kind of power-crept over the time. And also the late game was way weaker before, but now you just have these insane dragons and finishers, so the Master is just really the strongest region, and the one should oftentimes go nowadays in expeditions where cards are random. If you look at Constructed, we had dragons being popular as well, but now dragons are less popular, and it's more of an advanced tip. If you want to cheat the system, you should play decks that beat midrange. Since most decks are midrange, you should, if you are a more advanced player and want to learn a little bit more about expeditions and win more, you should try and prioritize these decks that beat midrange. And those are first and foremost Teemo, which is the only consistent combo deck in my opinion in expeditions. All the other combo decks are more jank and pretty reliable on getting the same cards over and over. Whereas with Teemo, you just slap Puffcap Peddlers into your deck and Puffcap cards, and you just are basically a deck that is able to win eventually, and it's really hard for midrange decks to outrace you. Other cards that beat midrange are like Vega and Lux, so they just generate removal spells over and over and are infinite value engines on their own, and it's really hard for midrange decks to have both the interaction to deal with them and the card advantage to outvalue them. And we have these high attack units that are cheap, and we see this in Constructed. Lurk is not really viable in Expeditions since it's too random and you need too many Lurk cards, but we see in Constructed there was a lot of dragons, and now there is no dragons because they get bullied by Lurk, and LeBlanc and the 5 attack units in Noxus do something similar. It just feels so bad to play a 5-5 and then your opponent's 2-drop, the 2-5 or the 5-2 trades into your 5-drop. This is why LeBlanc is generally a midrange slayer as well. It's just so hard for these midrange decks to deal with her. I want to prove this with showing my Lux win rate. This is mostly before the buff even, and I have like a 90% win rate with Lux over 37 games and expeditions. My lightest run was the 7-0 Bandle City run, and it's just a Lux and Poppy deck, more of a midrange deck, but Lux just basically bullies all of these midrange decks if you build her and play her correctly. Okay. On this occasion, I want to talk about something newer players often do, which is they add cards into decks for special matchups. For example, let's say you have Lux, and you have this game plan of usually banking mana on turn 1 and 2 to play a Remembrance on turn 3, and then all your Mageseek Investigators are online. You don't need this 6-cost spell for Lux, but all her followers want to see a 6-cost spell cast this game, so it's really good to play the 6-cost spell early so that all of your other units create value for you over time. Now, let's say this Lux player is afraid of LeBlanc and aggressive decks in general, which is true. LeBlanc is a midrange slayer, and oftentimes Lux decks are too slow for LeBlanc if they just go for a 5-5 turn 3 and the opponent has played a 5-2 quick attack on 3 mana, you just lose out on that exchange. And then they decide to introduce or to add a Vanguard Lookout to their deck. And what you should immediately notice is that this Vanguard Lookout really breaks up our traditional game plan with Lux. We can't bank mana on turn 2 if we play this Lookout, which means we can't play our Remembrance on turn 3. So we actively hurt our own game plan to include this card that helps us against aggressive decks. The problem with Vanguard Lookout, and why this card is so terrible, is how this curve really looks like. A perfect start from this Noxus deck would be Legion Rearguard on 1, then Farian Hopeful on 2 and LeBlanc on 3. If you look at our poor Vanguard Lookout, he just doesn't do anything against this curve. Yes, he blocks this 1-drop once or twice, but he can't even block the Noxus 2-drop successfully, so he's just a waste of a card, while also stopping our game plan we have in general. And furthermore, Lux is supposed to beat midrange decks because they can't really deal with a 5-5 on turn 3, but if you play a Vanguard Lookout instead, it just gets eaten by a Screeching Dragon and actively hurts our matchups. Now, let's look at a card that was specifically designed for this weakness that Lux has, which is Eager Apprentice. He says it's a 2-mana 2-1, which can actually trade against the 5-2, and he says, when I'm summoned, refill 2 spell mana. Another card that is really helpful is Mystic Shot, which also breaks up your curve of bank turn 1, bank turn 2, but can actively kill any of these units, like LeBlanc just dies to Mystic Shot as well. Notice how these cards are different region than Lux, so if you want to have this perfect synergy and if you want to be more prepared against these aggro decks, you have to switch into PNC instead, which again makes you weaker against these mid-range decks because Eager Apprentice doesn't help you against mid-range at all. If you want to stay in Demacia, your best bet would be a Silverwing Vanguard. This card comes down a little bit later, but at least you play this on turn 5, you block the 1-drop, and then you can clean up the 2-drop and the 3-drop with these Silverwing Vanguards. What I want to show you with this is A, most of these matchups or most of these archetypes are designed by two regions once more, and B, don't add cards to your deck for bad matchups if they affect your good matchups too much. So that was just a little of a sidetrack here, but this was something I wanted to talk about in one of my videos. Next up we have the gameplay points, because archetypes actively affect your gameplay as well. And this is because you can see your opponent's regions and champions at the beginning of the game. And this is something I really love about Legends of Runeterra in comparison to MTG, for example. I drafted a little bit of MTG, but you just don't have any information if your hand is good or not. You have no idea if your opponent is playing red-white aggressive or blue-black control. You have just no clue. But in Legends of Runeterra, you see your opponent's regions and champions, so you have an immediate idea. Are they aggressive? Are they defensive? Are they control? And champions, if you have no idea about the buckets, you can just look at the champions. Champions represent a big power spike in the game, and their cost shows most of the time how aggressive a deck will be. This is just a general tip. If you don't know all the champions or what they do, for beginners mostly, if you know what the champions do, it's obviously easier to read. I just want to show this point by comparing Lucian and Kalista to Garen and Thresh. Both of these have actually their card pools, but who do you think wants to be more aggressive? Lucian and Kalista or Garen and Thresh? It should be obvious just by looking at the mana costs that Lucian and Kalista want to be way more aggressive than Garen and Thresh, which would be more of a mid-range deck. Both Lucian and Kalista are vulnerable to removal spells because they have low health stats and have aggressive stats, aggressive keywords that help them attack, fearsome and quick attack. Garen's regeneration is good on offense and on defense because it's just also okay if he just blocks with his regeneration, whereas Thresh's challenger might be an aggressive ability, but this 6 health signalizes you that it's more of a mid-range to slower champion. If you look at these archetypes, Lucian Kalista form the Retribution bucket and Garen and Thresh form the Vault of Crowns bucket, and just by looking at the curve alone, you see a difference. Lucian and Kalista have a lot more early game units and cards than the Vault of Crowns, Garen and Thresh, which have more of a balanced card spread, even though they are in the same regions and basically the same region combination. And we see in Lucian Kalista in the Retribution a lot of these ephemeral cards that are more all-in style and want to flip their units as fast as possible, whereas in the Vault of Crowns side we have more of these value units. This means If you draft Lucian Kalista more midrange, you will have cards that don't really fit your deck at all, like Shark Chariot. If you draft Garen Thresh more aggressive, you have these more value units that don't really work out. But if you draft how your champions are supposed to draft, these buckets and synergy picks will actually reward you for staying in your archetype. And as an opponent, you can take a guess on how their deck is built. You can build Lucian Kalista as a midrange or even control deck, but A, the bucket doesn't really support that, and it will most likely just make them worse than a traditional control deck, and make your opponent just do a worse strategy than what they are supposed to do. That's why I always assume, if they have a 2-drop and a 3-drop champion, that they want to be more aggressive. And in the end, most of the champions, when played and drafted well, lead to mid-range decks that are a bit slower or faster. And here are some exceptions. If you see those from your opponents, then you have to think a little bit differently. We have Teemo, Hecarim, and Lee Sin. Those are the most notorious combo champions. Teemo and Hecarim being fast and trying to rush you down. You have to put up counter pressure because it won't really outlast Teemo or Hecarim ephemeral waves. Lee Sin can be shut down by a vengeance, but otherwise you will just die to him dragon kicking your units over and over again. Then we have Jasana, really the swarm archetype. It's all in her bucket. Lissandra, which is a early game champion but specifically designed for control, and Karma and Anivia, which are just hard control champions. And just, I want to mention Nautilus, he doesn't really lead to mid-range decks as well. There are multiple different ways, but that would be too far to talk about. Just be a little bit careful when you face a Nautilus. He plays more than a Teemo, than a usual mid-range deck. If it goes too deep, you just lose oftentimes, if they're good decks. You should always consider your opponent's champions and how fast the deck is, so basically the archetype in Mulligan and gameplay. Let's do some examples. Let's say we have our traditional Demacia midrange deck, and this is our starting hand. So just good cards. And if I would face another midrange mirror, I would actually keep this whole hand. We have a 3-drop. We don't really need 1-drops or 2-drops, since we will be able to use our spell mana later. And we have a strong 4-drop, strong 5-drop, and a strong interaction spell. So this hand would be the perfect hand for a midrange matchup. But you don't have to be afraid to be overrun, since our opponent also is more on the midrange side. If you face these two champions together, I would first of all mulligan Concerted Strike, since it can be easily stopped by Ashes Frostbites. And if you look at these champions, I talked about LeBlanc earlier being the midrange slayer, I would actually mulligan those two midrange units away as well and look for more 1-drops and 2-drops to block their 5-2s. It feels really bad to play a Screeching Dragon and like challenge a LeBlanc, just having the Screeching Dragon die against the 3-drop. That's just a terrible feeling. So that would be my mulligan against this specific, these two specific champions. Against a control deck like Thresh and Anivia, I would again mulligan Concerted Strike, since it can be easily broken up by Anivia's Frostbites or by Vengeance from Thresh. And I would also mulligan the Screeching Dragon, because I have to be more aggressive. The control deck will win the late game, since I am a midrange deck, so I have to find more early game. I can't just sit around and do nothing until turn 3. So this would be my mulligan against a control deck. Special thing would be against Teemo and Fizz. Again, Teemo, a combo deck, and Fizz is one of the most aggressive style decks you can build in the Fishbones if paired with PNC. So here I have to be aggressive in the early game, I have to put up pressure, and I would actually just mulligan this whole hand against Teemo. Shyvana and Screeching Dragon are just too slow. If you wait around to have Screeching Dragon kill the units, you will just die to Puff Caps. And I would actively look for cards like Fleet Feather Tracker and Dragon Card Lieutenant, just based on the archetype I expect my opponent to play. And I often see people just have generalized approaches to mulligans, like always keep your champions, always keep Screeching Dragons. That's just not how it works. You have a clear, you can see what your opponent's deck is and what archetype they're most likely playing, and you have to adjust your mulligan to that. It's even more important if you play more reactive style decks. If you, for example, Vega Darkness, and this is your starting hand. You have Vega, you have a small removal spell, you have a Vengeance, and a 3-drop. Again, the 3-drop is really important. If you don't have anything to do before turn 3, you would have to mulligan your full hand. Against mid-range decks, I would obviously mulligan the Vile Feast away. There's no good units to kill here with it, but I would keep this whole hand. We have a 3-drop, we have our win condition, and we have a Vengeance that will come in useful against any of these strike or fight cards. If you play against a Tristana Poppy, again, Tristana is the Swarm archetype, I would keep the Vile Feast, but mulligan the Vengeance. It would just be too slow against these Swarm units to just get overrun. And I would also mulligan away the Vega, and I keep my 3-drop. I just want to have more early interaction, and playing Vega on turn 4 is just too slow, or Vega is just too slow against these Swarmy decks. You just die if you do that. So I would look for more interaction, and if I survive this Swarm onslaught for long enough, I will just win anyways. I don't really need Vega to stack the Darkness. Against Control, I would actually mulligan away Vile Feast once more, just doesn't have any targets. And also would mulligan away Sly Sentinel, just looking for more value cards. And it doesn't really matter if I burn my mana early on, it's all about the late game, all about finding this value and interaction. And surprise to many, against Teemo, I would obviously keep Vile Feast since it kills Teemo. I would obviously mulligan the Vengeance. But I would also mulligan this Solari Sentinel, but I would keep this Vega. And this might surprise many people, but against Teemo, it's actually a race. And your only chance as a control deck is to put up more pressure and kill the Teemo fast enough. You can't sit around and try to kill the units, because Puff Caps will kill you. If it's a half a decent constructed Teemo deck, it loves going against this control. And it loves just playing 5 Puff Cap Elders and then putting 70 Puff Caps into your deck and just killing you from there. So I would actually keep Vega, because he is my most reliable win condition. These combo decks don't have a lot of interaction most of the time, so I can stack up my Darkness and oftentimes win on turns 7 and 8 before the Puff Caps kill me. So once again, very different mulligans based on the matchup I'm facing. Now for gameplay and playing around cards, I want to do a separate video after I've covered all the different regions, because playing around cards is a big subject and I want to devote more time and basically a full video, half an hour, around when you should play around cards and when not. But just by knowing your opponent's archetype, you can see which cards you should play around more or less. Let's take a look at Death Ray. If you think about turn 1, will they have a Death Ray in your deck? And you see a Teemo and a Victor. Just think about in which of these archetypes does this Death Ray make more sense. Victor is more of a mid-range style deck where you just play units on curve and get your value from graded cards, whereas Teemo is a combo deck. Does Death Ray help Teemo's combo? Does it put Puff Caps into the deck? Does it deal damage with the opponent's Nexus? No. So Death Ray would be a bad card in Teemo. That's why I don't expect Teemo decks to have Death Ray. Whereas I expect Victor decks to have Death Ray, since it's actually a okayish card in a Victor deck. Another example of this would be Elixir of Iron. If you look at Braum and Anivia, in which one would you think this Elixir of Iron makes more sense? Again, Braum is a mid-range deck, so he actually benefits from having these cheap combat tricks, because he plays units on the curve, and then often has one mana lying around and can surprise the opponent by these combat tricks. Anivia, on the other hand, is a control deck which wants to control the board and not really have that many units around, oftentimes use their mana or plan ahead of the turns. So Elixir of Iron would be a terrible card in an Anivia deck. So I don't play around this Anivia deck ever having Elixir of Iron. And this is how you can deduce from the opponent's archetype what cards they have in their deck most likely, or what cards don't make sense in their deck. And especially if you get to higher wins, these decks like Teemo decks that play Death Ray or Nivea decks that play Elixir of Iron, they just lose before that. So in the earlier rounds you might still encounter Teemo with Death Rays, but in the later the game goes, the less likely a Teemo will have Death Rays in their deck. Or later the 5 wins, 6 wins, 7 wins, then you can reliably tell that an Anivia deck won't have Elixir of Iron in it. Otherwise it's just a bad deck and wouldn't have gone 5, 6, 7 wins. But again, I will make a separate video about playing around cards. Another gameplay tip I want to give you right away is to always expect your opponent's champions. They are literally shown to you in the beginning of the game, so you should always consider, what if my opponent plays champion X here? What if they play champion X here? A big example of this would be playing your Silvering Vanguard on turn 4 when your opponent plays Twisted Fate. Then they play Twisted Fate, red card just kills your whole board. And I obviously have made this mistake before, but this is a big sign of autopiloting and not even playing around cards a little bit. And this is the bare basics you should do if you want to be a good expedition player. Look at your opponent's champions and always consider, what will I do when they come down? How will I treat them? Because they're literally cards you know they have in their deck. And especially with cards like Twisted Fate, you should always consider them. That's going to be it about how the archetypes affect the game. I hope I could show you that the game is actively built around these different archetypes, and some regions are more viable, some regions are less viable in expeditions because of how they cater to certain archetypes. In the next few videos, I will talk about the different regions and how they basically the region identity and what each region wants to do, so it should be even more clear which archetypes are more viable and less viable, and why midrange is just the most consistent and best option overall. I hope you learned something in this video, and thanks for watching. Check out our Discord as always, and I'll see you next time.